Good morning. I want to call to order the Joint Committee on Appropriations. I want to welcome our home listening audience and also those that are present in the room. Just as a reminder, if you're going to provide testimony, please sign in. Secondly, when you come to the podium and you answer questions, please identify yourself because the home audience doesn't necessarily see you, so they like to know who the speakers are. Third is silence your cell phones. I have a stiff penalty that goes to the charity of my choice, so just keep that in mind. With that, we begin our meetings with the Pledge of Allegiance, so I would ask you to join and stand. And I'm going to ask Representative Derby to lead us.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We have two pages in the room. I'm going to ask you before you leave, young man, you need to come to the microphone, tell us who you are, what school you go to, and if you've got any future plans.
Come right here. Oh, that's easier.
My name is Shane Rist. I'm from Centerville, and my future plans are go to Lake Area for agronomy.
Hi, my name is Savannah Hendricks. I'm a junior at Jones County High School in Myrtle, and my future plans are to make it to West Point, hopefully.
Well, thank you, and we appreciate you coming over here. I always say this is the best committee you have the opportunity to listen to, so thank you for coming. With that, I'm going to ask the secretary to take roll.
Senators and representatives, Otten.
Here.
Kasson.
Here.
Mills.
Here.
Wick.
Excused.
Duba.
Here.
Foster.
Here.
Johnson.
Here.
Kroll.
Here.
Maher.
Absent, excused.
Carr.
Absent, excused.
Koth.
Here.
Kolbeck.
Here.
Bolin.
Here.
Wink.
Absent, excused.
Van Huysen.
Here.
Breitling.
Here.
Derby.
Here.
And Hunhoff.
Here.
Madam Chairman, we do have a quorum.
Thank you. Are there some minutes out there, Representative Koth?
Madam Chair, I would like to move the approval of minutes from Tuesday, January 24th, where we heard excellent presentations, overview of the budgets from NSU, SMT, SDSU, AES, SDSU, EXT, USD, USD Law, USD Medical, and the Board of Technical Education. I move the approval.
Second.
It's been moved by Representative Koth, seconded by Representative Otten to approve the minutes of 1-24-23. All those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carried. Minutes are approved. With that, we will now move into our committee. Good morning. Absolutely, Senator Kolbeck.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just for the people in the audience and those listening online today, we do say the Pledge of Allegiance at the beginning of this meeting every day. And just to let you know that on the names of the flags that are presented behind the chairs, there are names of people that are represented on the basis of those flags, and they are very important to our state of South Dakota and to our United States of America. And one of those people on that United States flag is my dad, a World War II veteran who died August 1st, 7 years ago. And you'll see those flags throughout the Capitol here. And I just want you to know when you stand and say the Pledge of Allegiance that there are people that have dedicated their lives to this state and have dedicated their lives to this country. So I just wanted to make that well known, so when you do stand and salute the flag, that there are people that are being remembered because of that. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Kolbeck. A very worthwhile message to get out. With that, we're going to start with the Department of Education. So good morning and welcome.
Madam Chair, members of the committee, thank you very much for giving us this opportunity today to speak about our budget and our other financial issues that related to the Department of Education. I began my, I apologize. My name is Joe Graves. I'm Secretary of Education, and that's a new title to me, so I'm still getting quite used to that. So today we're going to be talking about a number of issues, and one of the things I've done is change just a little bit about how the Department of Education is going to present this to you today. When I was applying for this job, I was very excited about actually securing it and starting my duties. And one of the reasons for that was the fact that we have an extraordinary group of people who work for the Department of Education, especially in leadership and the 10 divisions that we have. These people are not new to me. I was a superintendent in the state for more than 22 years. And what that meant is I've had many contacts with the Department of Education. And in those 22 years, I did not have a single unprofessional or unhelpful phone conversation or in-person conversation. So when I knew this position was open, one of the reasons that I was excited about it was because of these people. They are professional. They have a great deal of expertise. They have a customer orientation, and they are extremely competent. And so when I started on the role, I wanted to see, are these people really as good as I think they are? And the answer is no, they're better. And so one of the things I've done today is I'm going to have these people each speak to you in turn when their particular area comes up. So we'll be doing that today as well. Outline of our presentation today, here are the members of the leadership team in front of you. We're going to be doing a quick summary of the DOE budget, followed by the governor's recommended budget, including information about each of our divisions. We'll have updates on one-time and special appropriations. We'll talk about the elephant in the room, the K-12 education and state aid, as that is the vast majority of our budgets, federal COVID funding, and, of course, future plans. This is our DOE budget in summary. You'll notice that the bulk of it, about 65%, is state aid. So the fact that we have a $1 billion budget is not an indication that we are a huge bureaucracy. Rather, it's an indication that a great deal of our money simply flows through. And so we have about 65%, again, that goes to the school districts through state aid. The second large one there is 31%. Those are pass-through grants. So federal grants come into us for Title I, Title II, and the other various programs, including special education, and then those pass through to the school districts. Finally, we have about 4% of the agency budget. So those are the dollars that pay for the administration and the various activities that the actual Department of Education does here in Pierre and in Rapid City. You'll notice we have our funding sources included there as well. The general fund is the major source of our money, about $700 million, about $350 million. For the federal authority, and then about $6 million from other authorities. This is our FY24 budget, and you're going to see here that we have some very minimal changes. So there's not a great deal of difference from the last year's budget. However, a total difference of about $24 million, again, that's a lot of money, but in a billion-dollar budget, it's not significant on that. We will be getting into the details of each of these items later in our presentation. The DOE workforce, so these are the people who work for us here in the Department of Education, both here and in Rapid City, as well as some other areas. Our organization looks like this. We have the Department of Secretary. We then have four budget centers, administrative services, ed resources, history and library services, and then you'll see the different divisions, including the Department Secretariat, child and nutrition services, K-12 services, finance and management, college, career, and student success, accreditation and certification, data and research, SPED and early learning services, and learning and instruction. What all of these divisions have in common is a commitment to lifelong learning and to providing targeted supports to school districts and other providers that pave the way for learning to occur. We'll talk more again about each of these divisions as we get there. Defining our workforce, we again have a group of very dedicated, hardworking employees at the Department of Education. The bulk of them, 40%, there really isn't a bulk, there isn't a majority here, but you're gonna see that we have about 45% of our people are in administrative services, 42 in ed resources, 40 in history, and then 21% in library services. This is how our workforce breaks down. We have a budgeted FTE, or a full-time equivalency, of 186, and that was the same in 21 and in 22. We also have a data on our utilized FTE, which refers to those we were actually able to fill. So in some cases, we have positions that are temporarily not filled or even permanently not filled. So you see that 186 in 2022 drops to about 176. Overtime did increase significantly from 630 to 936, or about 37 hours. And that reflects the fact that during COVID, we basically had a lot more COVID money coming through, and we had to ask more of people. So we were trying not to hire additional people so much as to use the people we had to deal with those issues, but a great deal more activity than usual. One of the things we always look at is our turnover rate. Turnover rate simply indicates which of our people or which of our positions left each year. And so in 21, that was about 7.7%. 22, about 15.2%. So about double. However, we don't see that as a major change. It's the trend is somewhere in there between about 7 and 10% usually. What we did see last year was we had a number of retirees. So part of this, I think, is the baby boomers generation is beginning to retire, and so we're seeing a little bit more turnover rate than we have in the past.
We have several questions. First is Senator Boland, then is Representative Van Huysen.
And thank you, Madam Chair. Dr. Graves, how many current people in the department are eligible for retirement at the present time? Would be in the next 3 to 5 years?
We do not have that data, but we will get that to you.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm.
Representative Van Huysen.
Madam Chair, sorry, took a bite there. Thought that question would be longer. Dr. Graves, first of all, congratulations on your position. I've known Joe for 13, 14 years and was very pleased by your appointment, so congratulations. Secondly, I appreciate this isn't the department workforce, but thought this would be as good a time as any to ask you, because coming from where you've been in Mitchell for so long and talking to superintendents, what do you see as the current status of the teaching workforce? Is it, we hear it's getting harder to fill positions, the vacancies are back up. I mean, what's your view of how that's gone over the last 5-6 years?
Madam Chair? Clearly we're having a teacher shortage right now, and we have for several years during COVID. We've seen people who are just leaving the profession in exasperation over COVID and some of the other issues that are going on. I do think that there's a strong projection right now for an economic recession. That will actually help the education profession, or usually does, because when an economic recession occurs, those jobs are starting to look better. Additionally, the Department of Education has enacted several programs to help school districts work on that issue. For example, in certification, we have been looking at reciprocity more seriously. We've also been looking at making the alternative certification process simpler and more direct. We have a mentoring program in place. It is actually since 2016. That has shown, and the data support this, it has shown a higher retention rate for those teachers in those first 2 years to stay in the profession. We have a program now for years 3 through 5, as well as leadership beyond that. But there is a definite shortage, and we know that. And frankly, what tends to happen is larger school districts have a little easier time of hiring, smaller have a little tougher time, simply because of geography. And the department is working on that, but it is a current situation that is definitely noteworthy and problematic.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Secretary Graves, if it's possible, I'm going to jump on to Senator Boland's question. When you get us the data on turnover or who's left, what I'd really like to see is, you know, what were the number of years that those individuals had been with the department when they left, and what positions were they holding? So I want to kind of get a better, more deeper dive picture into your turnover, because doubling your turnover in 1 year is a significant increase. Thank you.
Thank you. Representative Derby.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Welcome, Secretary Graves. If we could go back to defining our workforce slide, the previous slide, the FTE slide. Could you give me a definition of history and library services. What does that involve and mean?
Yes, history and library services is frankly a division of history, and that is the cultural center, and it involves. We're gonna cover that in a little bit as well, but it involves publishing the collection of South Dakota's history, and the operation of that center, as well as archaeological services. Library services runs the state library. And there was a time, I think it was 15 years ago, when parts of the collection were reduced because of the move to our e-books and those kinds of things. Nevertheless, we have a great deal of programming that occurs in the state library for those with disabilities that affect them, as well as the collection of South Dakota's documents and the maintenance of those as well. And we'll have more on that when that person comes up.
Thank you. You can continue.
Thank you. Oh, yeah, thank you. So as to the governor's recommended budget, I'm just going to find my place here. The first budget center is administrative services. And this includes three areas. And we'll have the director of each area share briefly about the work that his or her division does. I'll begin with my own, which is the Division of Secretariat and Legal. Our purpose is to provide vision, leadership, and direction for the entire department. We also provide legal services for the department, which is an increasingly critical area these days. We're responsible for official department communications. And we're also a liaison with the Board of Education Standards, which, as you know, is currently in a controversy, but going through the process of adopting social studies standards here in one additional hearing in February and then a final one with a vote in probably in April. At this point, I would ask Cody Stoser to talk about his particular area.
Madam Chair, Cody Stoser, Director of Finance and Management for the Department of Education. My division provides central services related to contracts, grants, budgeting, and accounting for all of DOE. We're also responsible for the distribution of state aid, flow-through dollars, which includes Title I, IDEA special ed, and recently COVID ESSER dollars, the Elementary and Secondary Schools Emergency Relief Fund, and other federal state grants that we receive. We also provide fiscal oversight for all these federal programs that we manage. So, thank you.
Thank you. The third one is the Division of Data and Research, or Big Data, for the Department of Education. And our interim director there is Joe Moran. Joe?
Madam Chair, members of the committee, good morning. Good morning. My name is Joe Moran. I am the interim director of the Division of Data and Research. Our team is composed of two offices, the Office of Office of Data Management and the Office of SD STARS, otherwise known as our State Longitudinal Data System. The Division of Data and Research is responsible for the development, coordination, and management of three primary data systems: the statewide student information system, the statewide personnel record form, and the department's State Longitudinal Data System. This effort involves many partners, including but not limited to all South Dakota accredited schools, approved programs, and several South Dakota bureaus and agencies, and as well as plenty of vendors. The most basic description of our duties is that our team facilitates the statewide student and staff data collection and reporting to meet the requirements of state and federal reporting.
Mr. Moran, the question is, when you talk about state and federal reporting, are you talking specifically about testing? So in other words, the NWEA, any of the tests that we're running in our school districts, is that what you're responsible for?
I would say we play a part in managing the data there. Our team directly is not responsible for the assessment work. That's the assessment office. So they would manage the data and the work of the actual assessments and student outcomes. We manage the data part of that.
Follow up. Can you give me an example specifically of what how you manage the data or what data it is that you're getting and how you're managing it?
Sure. So think of it as the Office of Assessments administers the test, works with districts in communicating those roles, implements the test, and then when they get the data back, that's where we come in. We play the supportive role of intaking that data, storing it, applying each student's score to their student profile, and then keeping that within the longitudinal system for a lot of back and forth.
All right. Thank you.
Yep.
Senator Foster.
Thank you, Chair. Would this refer to like literacy tests or what type of tests are taken?
Sorry, Madam Chair. I'm going to let the assessment off of the Division of Instruction and Learning answer those specific questions, if you don't mind.
Thank you.
Okay, call a friend. Is the friend here?
Chair, and I can wait if that's going to be covered in the later part of the presentation.
Covering that topic?
I certainly can.
Okay, all right.
Thank you.
So those are our three areas in administrative services.
Before you go on, maybe I missed this. So you had requested a position and it was denied, was not recommended. Is that correct, in administrative services? A data system architect and reporting manager?
Madam Chair, it's in our recommendation here. We'll get to that.
All right, I just need to know how you're doing this. So you're putting our budget, but you're going to address it someplace else.
Madam Chair, that's correct.
All right, thank you.
Madam Chair, Cody Stoser. In front of you, you'll see the FY23 base budget. This is where you'll see that data systems architect and reporting manager FTE that we were requesting. We were requesting that to move back from where it was housed from BIT to our offices, where that person, that FTE would be under us now.
So I'm going to stop you. So we all understand. So you're just transferring from BIT over to your office or your office to BIT?
Madam Chair, it is, we're transferring the FTE from BIT to the Department of Education.
Representative Van Huysen.
And this is perhaps a question for BIT, but are they cutting an FTE? And as
Madam
I said,
Chair,
if you need to defer to them on that, that's fine.
This is just a swapping of an FTE to us. So they're giving up the FTE to give to us.
So when we look at their budget, they're going down by one and you're going up by one.
Madam Chair, correct.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
So carrying on with the recommended budget for the administrative services, you'll see the tourism and tax distribution. In previous years, this is a tourism tax swap that we've requested. Part of this, we have an accounting assistant out in the archaeological center out in Rapid City that utilizes some of these funds. We are swapping that over to general funds in this request and returning the tourism promotion tax back to the Department of Tourism.
I'm going to stop you.
Okay.
So the tourism tax was paying this before. Now you are asking for general funds to pay for this. Is that correct?
Madam Chair, that is correct. We swapped the tourism funds back to Department of Tourism and asked general funds to take that's place right there.
Okay. Just to be clear on this, so they're keeping something they had sent away, and you're asking for now the general to pick these up. I just want so we all understand.
Yep, that's correct.
All right, thank you. Representative Van Huysen.
And just to elaborate on that, this is kind of like the last exchange. From the perspective of your department, this is a cash neutral deal. It's really a benefit to the Department of Tourism, correct? Because they get the extra money. You're just going to, $1 is as good as the other as far as you're concerned.
Madam Chair, that is correct. They're getting their normal tourism tax money and we're getting the general funds money on that.
All right.
Anything further?
No. Go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Our next budget center is Educational Resources. And this encompasses child and adult nutrition services, which, of course, is the school meals program in addition to some other related programs. It also includes K-12 services, which includes four divisions responsible for the agency core programming regulatory functions. These include accreditation and certification, college, career, and student success, learning and instruction, and special education and early learning services. To begin that, I'm going to ask the Director for Child and Adult Nutrition to come for Sherry Waterston, if you could, please.
Good morning, Madam Chair, Committee. I'm Sherry Waterston. I'm the Division Director for the Child and Adult Nutrition Services. Our division is responsible for the administration and fiscal oversight for schools, childcare institutions, food banks, and pantries that participate in the six United States Department of Agriculture food and nutrition programs. Most notably, the school nutrition program is what we're most noteworthy for. We provide training and technical assistance to agencies that operate our programs. We work with over 300 local agencies. 187 of them are public, non-public, Bureau of Indian Education, and tribal schools. We help to ensure that eligible South Dakotans, both young and old, have access to nutrition as well as domestic commodities. Thank you.
Thank you, Sherry. I would just add to that.
We have a question. Senator Boland.
Thank you. So how much of your duties and responsibilities go beyond the K-12, what I would, expectation, that's the word I'd have.
Madam Chair, primarily our responsibilities are K-12. We've got our school nutrition programs, which is the largest share of our federal programs. Our child and adult care food program primarily deals with child care institutions, family daycare homes, daycare homes. There is an adult daycare component to the child and adult care food program.
Oh, time out. Oh. Who's phone?
Somebody's in trouble.
Oh, yay.
Oh, that's a big
so my intern will do a head count of everybody here, and it's 25 cents per person.
Madam Chair, may I continue? Yes.
Just met Representative.
Record needs to reflect that was Wade Pogany.
Now, I just have an interjection. Are you the one that's retiring this year that was out? Is this your send-off?
Not anymore.
Not anymore. I apologize. I didn't mean to do that, but I couldn't pass the event up. So go ahead.
Madam Chair, to continue, so child and adult care food has that adult daycare component. So there's a small, right now there's currently no adult daycares in South Dakota on our program, but we occasionally there's some. Our adult work deals with the emergency food assistance pantry and commodity supplemental food program, which are senior boxes. So those are a very small sliver of the work that we do with our federal U.S. Department of Agriculture programs.
Okay. And I'm just going to assume that it's probably more efficient for you to handle this and to have a separate division in the Department of Social Services to deal with this. That's just my assumption. Would that be reasonably accurate?
Madam Chair, that's correct. They're operated under the same branch of the Food and Nutrition Service in Department of Agriculture. And it's fairly common for states to bundle these programs together.
Thank you.
Duba?
Thank you, Madam Chair. So just for my knowledge, and maybe for others on the committee, you have this large bucket of federal dollars. Do you distribute that to a school district, for example, based on enrollments, or how is that managed?
Madam Chair, good question. Our program is the child nutrition programs, school lunch, child care, summer food service programs, those are all meal reimbursement based. So a school that opts into these programs, they serve an eligible meal to an eligible child, and they get a federal reimbursement rate based on whether that child is approved for free meals, for reduced meals, or if they're paid meals.
Okay, follow up. So do we have a system that does that, or is that all paper? Please tell me it's a system.
Madam Chair, back in 2014-15, we moved from paper to an electronic system. Thank goodness.
Thank goodness. Thank you very much.
Madam Chair, at this time I'd like to introduce Dr. Catherine Blaha, Director of Division of Accreditation and Certification.
Good morning, Madam Chair and members of the committee. I'm Dr. Catherine Blaha. I am the Director of Accreditation and Certification. This is a small office. We staff within my office accredit the K-12 schools within South Dakota. Currently, there are 216 accredited schools. 149 of them are public, 48 are non-public, and 19 are tribal Bureau of Education schools. The Office of Accreditation also completes 40 to 50 district reviews yearly, and districts are on a five-year review cycle for accreditation. We also approve educator prep programs. There are currently 11 programs in South Dakota. There are five state programs, four private, and two tribal. In addition to these duties, we also certify educators. The Office of Certification processes approximately 4,000 certificates a year. These certificates can be grouped in the following categories of initials, renewals, alternative certifications, reciprocity, and those that are adding endorsements. Thank you.
Senator Foster.
Chair, yes. What would be considered a non-public school? Like, what type of schools are in under that category?
Those would be private religious schools, for example.
Thank you.
Madam Chair.
Representative Duba.
Thank you. And this is, relates back to Representative Van Huysen's question. From a certification standpoint, where are we at, or what are the data that you're seeing in terms of number of certification requests coming in? Are they going down? Are they going up? I mean, where are we at from a certified teacher's experience? And then a follow-up question would be, you talked about alternative certification. I'd like to understand that a little bit more, and I assume that's people that don't necessarily have the qualifications and are trying to get there.
Madam Chair. Representative Duba, the first question.
I'm going to ask you to pull the mic closer, or you sit closer, because we can't hear you.
I'm sorry.
No, don't apologize. We just want to hear you.
Okay. Could you repeat your first question?
Sure. What are the trends that you're seeing in terms of certified teachers in the state of South Dakota? Up, down? I know from experience in the education field, I've seen a lot of my friends leave it. So I'm really trying to understand where we're going or where we're trending over the last, let's say, 3 or 4 years?
It's been kind of an ebb and flow. Our recent data is showing that we do have an increase in initial certifications from last year to the current year.
So new teachers, right?
New teachers coming in, yes. There have been a slight drop in our renewals, but all our alternative certifications have been increasing for those initials. So if you would like more information, I would be able to pull something more solid together for you.
So maybe my question is, we need a little deeper dive into the data, maybe areas where you're seeing us drop, and you talked also about endorsement. So are we losing more science and math teachers? When you talk about alternatives, where are they going to be teaching? And also, what are the number of years that these teachers are when they're leaving the field? You know, how many years have they been in teaching? So just the data that you have surrounding our teacher certifications and where we're going with that.
I will be happy to provide that to you.
Thank you.
your other question addressed alternative certification.
Yes.
So alternative certification is for those individuals that already hold a bachelor's degree, but it is not connected with education. So they make their application, a district is willing to hire them. There is a plan of intent in place to provide, so they can get their education components. During that time, they are in classrooms serving as a teacher for our students.
Okay, then I've got others I want to ask.
Thank you. So from an alternative, does it vary based on what they're trying to teach? In other words, is that plan different? Let's say if I'm teaching high school science versus elementary, or is it pretty standard for anyone who's has an alternative certificate?
Madam Chair. So there are some cases that our alternative certification does look different. For our general ed, it's pretty standard, and I'm sorry about the vagueness.
No, understand. I'll look at the data when we get it. Thank you.
Representative Derby.
Thank you, Madam Chair. You mentioned reciprocity, and that's a hot topic here this session. So can you give us a little overview on reciprocity and where we're at with other states and kind of the continuum of that?
Madam Chair, when we look at reciprocity, these are applicants that are coming in from other states. When they come in, my office reviews their credentials to see how we can match that up with what we are offering in South Dakota. In regard to specific details of what states we're coming from, I would have to respond. I would have to get that information to you. That is a good question.
Are there barriers for reciprocity? Are we accepting most of those applications or not?
From my understanding, we do accept most of them. If there are some challenges where they are not quite in alignment, we do provide them with a note of deficiency of these are the things that would need to be addressed to allow them the opportunity to do that.
Just a follow-up, have you looked what other states do with reciprocity? Are we in the ballpark as to, you know, the simplicity or the ease of getting a license as compared to other states around us?
Madam Chair, I stepped into this position in July. I have a lot of learning to do. That is one of those aspects that I do need to look at. If you would like that information, I will provide that to you at a later date.
I understand. Thank you for explaining that, but maybe just keeping that in the forefront. One last question. There are not compacts then for teachers across the nation, education compact, that if I'm licensed in South Dakota, then I'm recognized. Do we have those in teachers?
We do not have that in South Dakota, Madam Chair.
But they don't have it nationwide either. Like I'm a nurse and I'm in a compact. South Dakota's in a compact, so I can practice in 35 states without question.
Madam Chair, yes. I need to review that.
All right,
to provide
thank you.
That information.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
We do not have a national compact for teachers. CSG has got a group that's forming a national compact. There are two states that have applied.
Madam Chair.
Representative Hassan.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm new to appropriations, and so I appreciate the high-level overview, and in the interest of brevity, it's appreciated, because as I'm learning on this committee, oftentimes that's not the case. But we do have, I do get a lot of questions in our communities on these things. Is there any way, because even like school and reduced lunches before, is there any way, like some of the bullet points that you're going through, that we could get a copy of those? If they're somewhere and I'm not finding them, you can point me in the right direction. Again, I'm very new to this committee. I just would like maybe some more in-depth information just to kind of go back over.
Madam Chair, we'd be happy to provide that.
Thank you.
Thank you for the request. You always want to keep us going, and I appreciate that, and I think it would be good for all of us. Great question. All right. Anything else?
Madam Chair, I'm going to add one item to that. One of the issues with reciprocity and alternative certifications is, unfortunately, it does open opportunities for individuals who are attempting to enter the field who perhaps don't belong in the field. And so one of the things we're trying to make sure we can do, and you will see this later in Senate Bill 39, we're trying to set up a process whereby we can catch individuals like that to make sure we're not sharing. So when you have a national compact or even reciprocity, one of the things that can happen is a person seeks certification in one state and then tries to get reciprocity to another with that, and it becomes a game of trying to catch an individual who's moving between states. So. At this time, we'll move on to the Director of the Division of College, Career, and Student Success, Laura Scheibe. Laura.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. As Dr. Graves indicated, my name is Laura Scheibe, and I am the Director of the Division of College, Career, and Student Success. To sum up the mission of our division, we help provide students with the tools they need to persist through to graduation and find success afterwards. We are divided into three offices. The functions the offices cover are overseeing our career and technical education program, primarily in the high schools, but we also have a role in the post-secondary side. The office also oversees the state-sponsored dual credit program. Another office is our Jobs for America's Graduates program. That is our dropout prevention and student engagement program. And finally, we have the Office of Student Wellness and Supports that supports just as the name says, student mental and behavioral supports. That includes programs such as school counselors and SD My Life. I'd be happy to stand by for any questions.
Representative Mills.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think I heard you say that you have a role with the tech colleges. Would you describe that role?
Madam Chair. Certainly. So our federal funding is called Perkins funding that funds CTE programs. And so part of that funding goes to the four public technical colleges, and then the rest of it goes to our high schools. So that's our role within the technical college system, is providing that federal funding.
I just have one question. Certainly talking with higher education and communication with K through 12, is it through your division that those engagements encounter?
Madam Chair, yes, our office does coordinate quite a bit with Board of Tech Ed as well as Board of Regents.
Thank you. Our next division is the Division of Learning and Instruction, and so I would invite Shannon Malone to come forward.
Morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. My name is Shannon Malone. I'm the Director for the Division of Learning and Instruction. When introducing the roles and functions of my division, I often describe us as all things ESSA, or Every Student Succeeds Act. The Division of Learning and Instruction is divided into three offices. The Office of Assessment and Accountability oversees our state assessments as well as the annual state report card. The state assessments include NAEP, or the National Assessment of Educational Progress, the English Language Proficiency Assessment, and all statewide assessments for English language arts, math, and science. The annual report card expands to not only state-level data, but we also provide the report cards for all public schools and districts. The Office of Standards, Learning, and Leadership is responsible for supporting quality instruction and effective educators through a variety of professional development. This office prepares and supports implementation of academic content standards. A couple of programs to highlight, and I know Dr. Graves mentioned the mentoring program. I just want to make a note that from 2016, when we started with roughly 300 first and second year teachers, we are currently up to a little over 1,300 first and second teachers and mentors. The program has grown from roughly 52 school districts to now around 90 school districts. So the program has seen a lot of success. And then I'd also like to recognize the exceptional educators, and we do that through the Teacher of the Year and the Milken Awards. The last office is the Office of Title Programs. This office provides administrative and fiscal oversight for federal title programs. Some of the title programs include Title I Part A, which includes targeted assistance and school-wide programs, Title III, which is the program to support English learners, and Title IV Part B, which is 21st Century Community Learning Centers. All of these federal programs provide a variety of training, professional development, and technical assistance. And I will stand by for questions if anybody has any.
Well, I just want to follow up. Senator Foster, you had a question early on.
Yes, and it may be a section for the special education, but it was just regarding what tests are available specifically around literacy.
So, Madam Chair, the state provides state assessments in English language arts as part of our statewide state assessment system. And that that English language arts includes literacy as a component.
Follow up. At what ages are they tested? At what grades?
Madam Chair, the federal requirement is that all students in grades 3 through 8, and then once in high school. And in South Dakota, we test at grade 11.
Thank you.
Representative Van Huysen.
Yes, thank you. Last year I was visiting with Secretary Sanderson, and she mentioned to me at that time that the department is exploring the idea of moving to the ACT as the standardized test, moving away from the Smarter Balance test, which I've always thought sounded like a brand of margarine. Is that still in progress, or what's the thought? I think that's a great idea. I mean, it would mean that if it's the standardized test that we require as the state, then the kids don't have to pay to take it. And we're already paying for another test, and it just seems, it makes a lot of sense to me. Can you speak to that?
Madam Chair, Representative Van Huysen, it's a great question. It's one that is certainly on our docket for discussion. When we bring a group of school administrators and educators together over the course of the next 3 to 5 months. So our state accountability system is federally approved through our state plan. And as I mentioned, in South Dakota, we test at grade 11. We have had a lot of requests from school administrators across the state over the last several months for us to consider utilizing ACT as our 11th grade assessment. As you can imagine, with any assessment, there are a lot of quandaries that we need to consider. A couple that come to the table, and as we're speaking of budgets, is can our budget support moving to ACT? I think that we need to be realistic about what are we paying for our state assessment for 11th graders currently versus what would it cost if we wholesale took on ACT as that state assessment. So that could potentially be something that we would need to consider budgetarily. The other is ensuring that all of our students, including our special ed students and our English learner students, are provided the supports and accommodations. And I know that ACT has done a lot of work over the last several years to ensure that those students do have accommodations, but that is another point of contention that we've had to, that we will be weighing out over the next several months to ensure that all students can be provided the same assessment in a fair way.
Thank you for that response, and I would just add, certainly not a blank check, but even if it was a little more expensive, we got to keep in mind that it would be a cost savings to every student in the high, so it might be worth it even if it's a little more for us. Thank you.
Senator Bolin.
Yeah, thank you. Now, in your role, do you deal with Indian education at all?
Madam Chair, our division provides assistance and support to the Office of Indian Education. When it comes to, say, the OSEUs, the Osheti Shakowin Essential Understandings, we do play a role because they are part of our purview for reviewing content standards and the adoption of those standards. It is then the Office of Indian Education that is responsible for providing ongoing technical assistance and support to school districts to ensure those standards are being implemented as districts see fit.
Okay. Follow-up question. Now, is the Office of Indian Education, is that under the Department of Education or under Tribal Affairs?
Representative Hunhoff, it is currently under the Tribal Affairs. I'm not sure.
Okay.
Of Tribal Affairs.
Department of Tribal Affairs. Let me continue to go down this line. Where, what steps, I mean, does this, the fact that that is in one department and other education things are in under your purview, the Department of Education, does that cause difficulties, liaison issues, a host of things that would make that whole process more difficult in your judgment? And I know this is a little, I'm putting you on the spot here. You don't have to answer, you don't want to.
Madam Chair, I will say that in my position, I feel as though we have a great working relationship with the Office of Indian Education. We include them on a variety of committees and are in partnership with them regarding a variety of educational topics throughout the entire school year.
Okay, thank you. I'll just make one brief comment. I think we should bring it back into the Department of Education. That's my view. Thank you.
Representative Duba.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Ms. Malone, you talked about the mentoring program. Can you, and you said it's expanding and it's been very successful. So what is the DOE's involvement in that? So do you source the mentors? Is there a structure to it? How does that work?
Great question, Madam Chair. The department does annually, we do a reach out to all public school districts across the state to ensure that any district that wants to have teachers participate in the mentoring program have that opportunity. As I mentioned, there are roughly 90 districts that currently participate. It's not necessarily an application process per se, but it's similar to that, where the first and second year teachers submit their information, and then if we can partner them with a mentor in their district or in their building, that would be the first placement that we would look towards. If there isn't anyone available in their school or in their district, then we will seek out other mentors from other districts from across the state.
Follow up. So what data and metrics and structure do you put around this to know if the program is successful? How do we measure success?
Madam Chair, great question. I think that the success comes in how many first and second teachers go on to be third, fourth, and fifth year teachers. And I don't have that data point in front of me directly today, but I can get that for you. And I would say it's significantly.
Yeah, Madam Chair, if I could, approximately 72% of the teachers who do not go through mentoring continue on to grade years 3, 4, and 5. It's about 10 percentage point higher, about 83% are retained of those who go through the mentoring program.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, you can proceed.
Madam Chair, I would just add on the ACT question, one of the reasons that many school administrators are pushing for the ACT is that they don't feel that the Smarter Balance test provides any skin in the game for 11th graders. 11th graders have reached an age where they can kind of like, well, what's this test worth to me? And if the, well, it doesn't really matter to you specifically, it'll be recorded, but, and so then the idea is they're not taking it seriously. On the flip side of that, however, is the ACT test itself is being used by fewer and fewer colleges. That trend may stop or even reverse, but right now we're seeing some colleges in interests of equity are deciding not to even offer those kinds of college entry exams or take those testing scores. So two of the things we're measuring as we look at that process. And at this point, I would like to introduce Linda Turner, our Director of the Division of Special Education and Early Learning.
Madam Chair, members of the committee, I'm Linda Turner. I'm the Director for the Division of Special Education and Early Learning, and our division provides training and support to districts, families, and other entities related to children birth through age 21 with disabilities. We also provide administrative and fiscal oversight for the programs of Birth to Three, Head Start Collaborative, Special Education Preschool for students age 3 to 5, and Special Education General programs that covers birth through 21. The Birth to Three program provides family-centered early interventions and services and supports to eligible children at no direct cost to families. These are provided through 7 regional service coordinator programs, and direct services are provided by districts and providers for early intervention services. The Head Start Collaborative facilitates collaboration among the Head Start agencies and entities that carry out activities for low-income children in the state from birth through school entry. The South Dakota has 6 tribal Head Start entities and 8 non-tribal programs, and that includes 135 centers across the state. preschool services provide are provided by districts for eligible students age 3 through 5, and special education programs works with districts, state agencies, and families to provide services and supports for school-age children that are eligible in one of the 14 disability categories. Thank you.
I just have a question. Are the disability categories only physical disabilities, or is there cognitive and behavioral health in that?
Madam Chair, it includes the full spectrum of disabilities, mental and physical, cognitive, emotional, and social disabilities. So depending on their needs and if they meet the eligibility criteria, they can receive services.
Okay, can I just ask one more and then I'll go to you because it's on the topic. So if I have a DD child that's less than 21, can they be receiving supports both from education and from DD or DHS also? That child could get resources from both?
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Beginning at age 16, students who are eligible for special education are required to have a transition plan. And part of that transition plan is coordinating with other agencies and entities that may provide them services. As they are making that transition, we have project skills and things which are collaborative efforts between the agencies that work with students when they are still in high school and then transition them to the vocational resource services as they graduate.
One last question and then I'll stop. If that child needs special equipment and they're at that 16, 17, who then compensates? Is it education or is it human services if the family made the request for that special device or whatever piece of equipment?
Madam Chair, if it is necessary for the school or the student to benefit from public education, the school district would be responsible. If it is something that may be needed in the home only, then we would work with appropriate agencies to determine how that would be funded.
Thank you. I appreciate your indulgence. Senator Foster.
I'll hold my question.
Senator Boland.
Thank you. Over the years, we've had quite a few controversies about dyslexia being included within disability standards. Could you comment on the current status of that, or have there been any changes? Where are we with dyslexia in this whole range of questions? Thank you.
Madam Chair, dyslexia generally falls under the category of specific learning disability. It's specifically cited as one of the areas that students may be eligible for under that category. Depending on the student's needs, they may be considered in other eligibility categories. Dyslexia is defined separately, not as a disability, but just dyslexia is defined through statute that was done a couple years ago. But dyslexia has always fallen under the eligibility category in special education if the students met the educational need and had a disability in that area.
Thank you.
Senator Foster.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair. Are there tests given to students that will, are they tested specifically for dyslexia?
Madam Chair, there is no state requirement currently to test all children and do a screening on all children to see if they have dyslexia. If there is a concern for individual children, districts may have screening tools that they have selected that would cover the broad range of students in their district, or for individual students, if there's a concern and there's going to be testing done, then the team determines what tests will be most appropriate to administer. And we provide a list of assessments that are considered valid and reliable and provide training on assessing students specifically with dyslexia.
Follow up. Is there any mechanism in place if a student with a literacy test that's given, I guess, around third grade, is there like a follow-up process to identify or eliminate dyslexia and other special needs areas? Is there a mechanism in place that automatically will qualify them for further testing?
Madam Chair, that the state assessment would be one piece of information that the school district would use in looking at their students to determine if that may be something that they want to refer on for further evaluation. Many districts have a school-based intervention team or multidisciplinary team that looks at student data and recommends interventions and strategies to try for students, and they could suggest that they have that student tested further.
Follow up.
Okay.
Can you send a link to a report that has more in-depth information about that process and criteria?
Madam Chair, I'd be happy to send that.
Thank you. Representative Duba, then Representative Auten.
Thank you, Madam Chair. One more question specific to dyslexia. You did say, Mrs. Turner, that we don't currently require any testing for dyslexia. Is that because it's cost and time consuming based? Because I know that testing for dyslexia is a much longer process. Is it based on cost, or what is our decision making process around that?
Madam Chair, when we have had these discussions previously, the provision of and selection of a statewide screening tool, it has been opted through legislative session not to require a specific instrument that all districts administer, part based on cost, part based on time, but there have been many reasons why the state hasn't pursued that.
Representative Auten.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Do we know a cost, exactly what a cost was and what a cost for the state would be on that?
Madam Chair, I don't have a recent cost analysis, and it would depend on what instrument or what evaluation was required, as well as the if you wanted to include teacher personnel time to administer that, the number of grades it would be administered at. But we could certainly work on a calculation if you provided more details.
Just to clarify, Madam Chair, are you referring to a test that would be for all students, a representative, or that would be geared to students who are having issues with reading?
Madam Chair, I would think that we could take the scope and squeeze it a little bit and go to those that we would already identify that they're having some problems reading or some that could be identified.
Any other questions? Okay, move on.
Thank you, Madam Chair. At this time, I'd like to have Cody Stoser come back to the chair and talk about budget.
All right, Madam Chair, Cody Stoser. Up on the screen, you'll see the budget request for Ed Resources, the divisions that just spoke to you all. We have two relatively minor changes. One is to the BERTA 3F map, which is the expected increase in state shares of the state share of Medicaid costs related to the BERTA 3 program. And the second is the expected savings due to the Medicaid expansion at the federal level. And then that you'll be able to see the recommended operating and personal at the bottom there. Then we'll move into Ed Resources for our FY23 amendment. The first one is additional CANS authority from the federal authority of $7.7 million. This is due to the passage of the Keep Kids Fed Act of 2022, which increased reimbursement rates for school meals and meals/snacks served at under child and adult care feeding programs, the CACFP programs. The increase was a 40-cent increase for school lunches and a 15-cent increase for school breakfast. Then there was a 10-cent increase for meals and snacks under the child and adult care feeding program.
Can I just ask that last one, what kind of receivers of what are the entities that get those dollars?
Madam Chair, that would be your all the school nutrition program, the schools that are on the school nutrition programs, and then the child and adult daycares that are on that program that it's approved through the child and adult nutrition services.
To the ones that the daycare that are approved, so that would have to mean that they were licensed in order to be receiving that?
Madam Chair, that's correct. They'd have to be licensed.
So my question to you is this. Is that a mandate by the state that puts in, or does the feds put that in, that they have to be licensed?
Madam Chair, that's a federal.
And I'll just double on that. Does that mean the federal gives the option, or they just say that that's the only, you have to be a license to get it?
Madam Chair, you have to be, sorry about that.
Okay, one last question. Are there any waivers on that, that daycare providers could be waived in to get that service?
Madam Chair, currently there are no waivers.
I'm trusting that answer. Senator Foster.
Thank you, Chair. I have a question regarding the schools that are eligible. In a previous statement, there was 149 public schools and 48 non-public schools. Are non-public or private schools eligible for those food services as well?
Madam Chair, yes, any schools is eligible for them if they are approved through the Child Adult Nutrition Program and complete their agreement with us.
Thank you.
Can I just follow up? Are those private schools, do they have to be licensed to receive the services? Or accredited, whatever the terminology.
Accredited schools, Madam.
So not all private schools are accredited, so if they're not accredited, they aren't able to access those, correct? Thank you. Representative Duba.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And this may be for our head of child nutrition. Obviously, during COVID, the federal government passed a, you know, emergency act to allow to feed all of our school children breakfast and lunch. We've recently discontinued that. We've seen rising debt for school children across the state of South Dakota. I know you're aware of it. What would it cost us, the state of South Dakota, to take on that expense? Do you have a sense of that?
I don't have those, Madam Chair. I don't have those numbers with me, but that's something we can get because of the past 2 years of all free meals served to students.
Yeah. Now I know why I had to account for all those meals when kids were coming through during that free time. I'm like, why am I tracking this? But that's why. So, and there's just one more. Are the school districts telling you what their debt ratios are? Do you know that? Are they sharing that with you? In other words, number of students and what the debts are, or do you have any sense of that? I know it was $100,000 in the Sioux Falls School District.
Madam Chair, the unpaid meal, the student debt, is not something the schools report to the state.
Sure.
We've heard it in the media, just as you have.
Yeah.
We do have participation data, so we know that meal participation has declined now that parents and families are responsible for paying some of the meals.
All right. Well, I appreciate that. Thank you. I'd like to see that data.
Senator Bolin.
Yeah, thank you. And continuing on this line, though, any child who's below the poverty level, they're going to be on free lunch anyway, right? They would not be, that wouldn't be involved with this debt issue.
Madam Chair, that is not necessarily the case.
Okay, explain that.
We do have a method to directly certify free meals to students that are eligible for Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program. People used to know that as food stamps, or Temporary Assistance for Needy Families, TANF, Foster, Homeless, Migrant, Head Start. And I'm missing one category, but we do have a method to directly identify a large number of students eligible for free meals. There are household applications, however, for that families must fill out if they're eligible based on income. And of course, all of our reduced price students have to fill out an application.
Follow up on that. What for reduced price lunches, what's the percentage?
If
it's reduced price, is it a 50-50? The parent pays half and the federal government pays half. What's the percentage?
Madam Chair, the reduced price cost of breakfast is 15 cents per meal and lunch is 40 cents. The federal government provides a reimbursement rate to take care of the rest of the meal.
So if I could continue. So it sounds to me as if the federal government is paying the vast majority of the price of the reduced price meal. Would that be accurate?
Madam Chair, that's true, yes.
Okay. And so one more follow-up, if I could, Madam Chair. So in reality, for those students who would qualify as for free lunch or free breakfast, if they aren't receiving that service, it's because the form hasn't been filled out. Would that be generally true?
Madam Chair, that's correct.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Yeah. Okay, one more and then we need to move on.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Could you give us a breakdown of the percentages of the number of children across the South Dakota that are falling into the free and also into the reduced so that we can see the data? And even if you have that data from, let's say, 3 years ago to today. So I want to know if we're trending upward on free and reduced or staying flat or going down, if you do have that data.
Madam Chair, I do. We just got the data end of January.
Thank you very much. Appreciate that.
So percentage, I have percentage free and reduced bundled, but I have eligibility or number of students. So this year's free and reduced total percent is at 35.2%. And the last normal school year, normal pre-COVID, normal operation of the school meal program was in school year 19-20, and we were at 40% free and reduced.
Thank you. Okay, anything else? Okay, let's keep moving.
Madam Chair, we'll move along with the Ed Resources FY23 amendment. The next on the line is the Federal Authority for the Supply Chain Assistance Funding, roughly $5 million. This was additional federal money that the state received through the U.S. Department of Agriculture through their Commodity Credit Corporation to assist schools in supply chain issues that they are having. The next one is a dual credit reduction of $194,000. This is this expected decrease in the number of credits that is that we expect this year. And we'll get more in the next slide on this when we move forward. So, and then the next item on the amendment is the enhanced FMAP percentage, and it's $13,500. And then a governor's recommended the Stronger Family Initiative of $15 million, and we'll get into that on the coming slides too. Okay. So dual credit, part of our dual credit reduction here you'll see on the slide is our 2022 credits paid. Roughly a total of 39,748 credits were paid for that. It's an increase of 7% from 2021 to 2022. You'll also see the revised 2023 credits that we are putting on our amendment here. We revised that down to 42,699. You know, on the right-hand side, you'll see what we budgeted for credits. And then the cost per credit to the state is $96.67. And the total, the FY22 request was $4.3 million. The amendment brings that down to roughly $4.1 million that we expect to spend.
Okay. Thank you.
Just a minute. How did you come to decrease that? I'm looking at the numbers. It looks like it's gone up. So tell me what your rationale, your formula was.
Madam Chair, it's So yes, the credits have gone up from 22 to 23, but when we do projections, we do on a projection base of what we think is going to happen in 23, and we haven't got all the information from the colleges on how many credits earned yet. So now we are projecting that we will come up a little short of what we projected at the beginning of the year.
Okay, what is leading you to that conclusion? I mean, where are you seeing the decline? I'm just asking. You're like pulling a number and you're not giving us a rationale. Do you flip a card or flip a coin and decided that, you know, I'm just, what's the process? Put you on the spot. Thank you.
Madam Chair, this is Lisa Wright with the Department of Education. I don't flip a coin and I don't pick a card. I wish I could. But no, I take the historical information of the credits that we have paid in the past and move it forward. And so I look from 22 to 23, and that's why we say there was a 7% increase. Last year, we were in front of appropriations reverting $615,000 last year. And so with that increase, we're saying that based on the history, credits are increasing, but we're still not up to that $4.3 million that we do anticipate spending out in FY24. Does that help?
Better than the flip in the card. Thank you.
If I can just speak about a minute. Basically, what happened was last year, we did not spend all the money to the tune of $650,000. This year, we expect more students, but not to exhaust that same $650,000 and thus the projection. So the numbers are going up, and we'll see the additional monies that we had available go down, but it will still be a reduction.
So then I have a question. Is there a reserve that's sitting here of dollars that haven't been used when I'm looking at this? When you just said that you didn't use, is there like a block of money?
Yeah, Madam Chair, the allocation is roughly $4.3 million.
Thank you. So our next area is the State Historical Society, and at this point I would like to introduce Dr. Ben Jones.
Good morning, Madam Chair. Dr. Jones, Director of the State Historical Society. As you can see on the slide before you there, the Historical Society is comprised of these five, sections. The Archaeological Research Center is in Rapid City. The other four, the Archives, Historic Preservation, the Museum, and Research and Publishing is housed in the Cultural Heritage Center here in town. The statutory responsibility for the State Historical Society is under Title I, Chapters 18 through 20, the Historical Society was created by the legislature and the governor in 1901. It's responsible for collecting, preserving, interpreting, and publishing the history of South Dakota for current and future generations. And as something to highlight, this area, as many of you may remember, is undergoing a renovation, which will begin soon, and we have another slide on that coming up. About that special appropriation that was approved last year. We can go ahead with that.
Mm-hmm. Madam Chair, Cody Stoser. On the screen in front of you, you will see the State Historical Society's recommended budget for FY24. On the screen, you'll see the tourism promotion tax distribution, the tourism swap that is requested, general funds of $941,000 that we would receive. Other authority, it's $688,000 that we would revert back in that area for the tourism swap. On the bottom, you'll see the personal services.
We've got questions. Slow down, please. Representative Van Huysen.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Sorry, real quick, why aren't those two numbers the same?
Madam Chair, good question. As a tourism, as a tourism taxes increase, so has our other as the tourism tax increased, the percentages that came over to us, we've funded additional projects or other things that's happened with that increase. So we want to keep that other authority to help keep that those funding of projects going in our department.
Senator Colbeck.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just a question on the FTEs. We know that the Historical Society building is going to be under construction here for 18 months or whatever it might take. Who's absorbing those FTEs at that point in time, or what happens with those people? Thank you.
Madam Chair, you mean what are they going to be doing?
That is exactly right. Thank you.
No, we thank you. Good question. We found other spaces that they would move to and to be able to do their jobs. And we've worked with the vendor that's the contractor to find storage for the archives and whatnot inside the building. And we have space for our employees other than the museum that'll be. They'll be taken out.
Just quick follow-up. Thank you. Because I know you got to move everything out of that building, right? And you got to locate it in different locations, either in Pier or outside of the state or outside of Pier somewhere. Some may end up in Sioux Falls at the pavilion or wherever. Will those employees be used at those locations? You know, because there's going to have to be somebody maybe kind of talk about those and show people the archives that are coming out of that building?
Madam Chair, and Dr. Jones can get into this a little more, but most of the employees will be here in town where we acquired space for them. I know it's been discussed about moving some archives or things to other places like down in Sioux Falls and whatnot, but he would be able to answer that more directly on if people were there to talk about those things or what agreements we have with the museum down there in Sioux Falls.
Thank you. I'm just curious, how does the federal government give us approximately $1.3 million to run our own state historical society? Am I reading this right? Federal is $1,295,582. How's that work? I mean, are they that, they give us money to run our state historical society. It's staggering to me.
Madam Chair, them are grants that are applied for, that they do certain things with archives and other things in the museum. And then maybe if Dr. Jones come up and talk more about those federal grants, that'd be good.
Dr. Jones from the Historical Society. Primarily that federal funds the preservation of the historical preservation. So the National Park Service, when we dole out grants, the grant money comes from the National Park Service under the Department of Interior. And so the Historical Preservation Office within the Historical Society is 70% of the personnel is funded from the Department of Interior for their salaries and benefits and so forth. And then the grants, some of the grant programs are also from NPS.
Okay, just a brief follow-up. Thank you, Madam Chair. Is this perpetual on a regular basis? Is it just expectation this will, so it's just really not, it's not a temporary grant, it's perpetual, is that right?
Madam Chair. It occurs every year based on the federal budget guidelines that are passed or not in a continuing resolution that Congress makes. But yes, the expectation is that every year the NPS will give us those grant dollars to make those salaries and make those grants.
Thank you.
Our next section is the library services, and at this point, I would invite George Seaman, the director of the South Dakota State Library, to come forward.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Graves. Madam Chair, committee, it's a pleasure to be here. South Dakota State Library has three, yes. Yes. George Seaman, State Librarian. Thank you. The South Dakota State Library has three offices. We have Outreach and Development, Access Services, and Braille and Talking Books. The State Library is charged with conducting activities outlined in codified law. Those are promoting adequate library services for all South Dakotans, supplementing services of local libraries, providing training for library personnel, providing specialized library services and materials, operating state publication library distribution program, and collecting and reporting annual data. In carrying out this work, we serve 142 public library outlets, which encompass 106 main branches, 30 branch libraries, and 6 bookmobiles, as well as 395 schools and 15 academic libraries. The state library facilities, we take care of statewide interlibrary loan programs, offer an extensive slate of training and opportunities for any library personnel, trustees, or anyone that would like to attend. We coordinate the summer library program, provide library services for South Dakotans that are blind, visually impaired, unable to physically hold a book, and for children with reading disabilities through the Braille and Talking Books program. We also provide 58 electronic resources that are accessible to all South Dakotans, and those resources are accessible through location IP. So if you're in South Dakota, you should be able to access those without logging in. A few of these resources include Learning Express, World Book, Ancestry Library Edition, and EBSCO K through 12 and higher education research resources, which are purchased in partnership with the South Dakota Board of Regents. Use of the electronic resources have skyrocketed since the pandemic. They went from 2.82 views in fiscal year 2019 to 4.35 million views in fiscal year 2022. And we're excited about a new program that we'll be launching here Monday, and that is going to be a program that we are partnering with Game Fish and Parks to check out transferable entry license passes to patrons to go and visit a state park. And those will be 3-day passes, so they can go and visit for 3 days and then bring the pass back. These will be available at public and academic libraries. Thank you very much for your time, and I stand for any questions you have.
Senator Colbeck.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just got a question. What is the 504 visual plan that school district's going to, that students in a school district can fall under to get support? Is that the plan, the 504 plan, I guess they call it? I got that from my school district, and then because I asked them, I said, how many students do they actually have underneath, visual, care, and they got, it amounts to about 27 total students but they got 3 under the 504 plan, but I don't know what that is. Do you know what that amounts to? Is that help from you guys?
Madam Chair, I actually don't know. I've never heard of that. That might be.
Yes, Senator, a 504 is a federal guarantee of a student who has issues that do not rise to the level of special education. Now, you can be a special education identified student and a 504 student, but typically a student is one or the other. And so if a student has not tested and been qualified for special education, one avenue that a parent has is to have a 504 plan. So a student may have some characteristic, some aspect, can be any level, can be physical, can be behavioral, can be social. They can seek a 504 plan, and the district can then complete a 504 plan. They're not required to. There can be the same kind of an issue whether they qualify for one or not in 504. But it's generally deemed less complicated to have a 504 plan. And once you have a 504 plan, then the district or the school agrees to provide certain accommodations to the student, certain extra services. And the major difference of that is a special education provides the funding for that, and a 504, it comes out of the general fund of a school district. Does that answer the question? Okay, thank you.
Representative Van Huysen.
Yeah. For the state library and then the state archive, too. Could you speak to the difference between a library and an archive? I ask that because, for example, when I want to look at certain government records, which I occasionally do, you'd think those are in the state archive, and maybe they are, but I find them in the state library. I've always been a little confused about the distinction. Can you speak to that?
Yeah, absolutely I can. Madam Chair? The difference is libraries provide access to materials. Archives are meant to preserve those materials.
So that's why they let me into the library and not the archive. That's what you're telling me?
Madam Chair, that is correct.
All right, yes. Thank you.
And you look a little shady, so, you know, we got to watch for things here. Yeah.
Questions? Okay. Thank you so very much. Before we move into the next, is the Stronger Families the next?
Let's see.
Is that what you were looking through?
Madam Chair, it goes into a talk about the FY21 amendment that Dr. Graves will go through.
Okay. Under library services?
Oh, sorry. Yeah, we'll go through the library services budget really
quick.
Okay.
Okay.
Basically, there's no change to FY23 to the FY24 recommended budget. 21.5 FTE at roughly $3.4 million. So, and then at the bottom of the screen, you'll see it's how it's divided out between personal services and operating expenses.
Okay. Any questions? Okay. What I'm looking for is to take a little recess here. Mm-hmm. So we'll take a, did you have a question?
Yeah, well, when we recess, I
All right, so we're going to recess here for 10 minutes. However, I want to tell you this, so in all fairness, so you know, you are scheduled to go to noon for the budget hearing. I will ask you to at least complete by about 11:35, 11:20, because we will take public input at that time. So just so we're on, and all of us have meetings starting at noon, so we're on a time frame, so I'd appreciate that.
Thank you.
We'll go into recess right now.
Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Links to live events and their archives are available at sd.net. You are listening to South Dakota Public Broadcasting's live webcast service on the South Dakota Network. More information at sd.net. Thank you.
We are back out of recess, and we'll start with a continuation of our Department of Education presentation.
Thank you very much. To beginning now, we have the Stronger Family Scholarship. This is an extremely important new initiative that we're engaging in, and at this time I'm going to ask Laura Ringling to come up and speak on that. I will say, just as an introduction, when a child goes into foster care, it's an extremely disruptive situation for the child. And the intent of this, among other things, is to take some of the worst situations out of that and give them some advantages as they go through that system. Laura?
All right. Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. Laura Ringling with the Governor's Office. So the bill that accompanies the $15 million appropriation is Senate Bill 100. And this bill would establish the Stronger Family Scholarship Program. This would be a three-year pilot, which would provide scholarships of up to $4,000 to eligible youth in Department of Social Services custody. These funds would be able to be used for tutoring and teaching services, curriculum, online learning programs, private school tuition, standardized achievement tests, certain transportation expenses, and technology used for educational purposes. So, as the Secretary indicated, we know that youth in foster care face disparate educational outcomes compared to their peers. This can be due to trauma or just mobility due to out-of-home placements that can increase the frequency of those mid-year school transfers. Those transfers can result in gaps in the youth's learning cycle as they adjust to their new settings and new teachers. We know these youth have more issues accessing consistent resources and building those relationships that are crucial to being successful in school. We believe that by providing scholarships, we'll allow access to supports and services that are in addition to the supports and services that they receive in their school setting. These resources can help close gaps, help students delve deeper into certain subjects, and just allow the child to do some work outside class at their own pace. These additional resources can also help students foster positive relationships with other adults that can help serve the youth and provide a protective factor against negative educational outcomes. So really, this program is about ensuring youth in foster care can receive access to a full range of services and just additional opportunities and supports. This would be a three-year pilot. As I indicated, the Department of Education would administer the program for students in public school, and a scholarship-granting organization would administer the program for students that are attending private school. With that, I would stand by for any questions that the committee has.
Okay. Representative Van Huysen.
Thank you, Madam Chair. A couple questions. Ms. Ringland, can you tell us about how many foster kids there are in the system who are school age? I know people go in and out, but what's the annual average?
Sure. So we know that our four-year average of individual youth in DSS custody is around 1,700. We would imagine between 1,000 and 1,200 are school age at any given time.
Okay, thank you. Another question. I have to admit, I don't know how this works, so if you could explain it. A child who's in foster care is a ward of the state, at least in some cases. They're placed with a foster family. That's not their, I mean, they're not adopted. It's a foster family.
Yep.
what's the process for making decisions about, you know, which school do we send them to? Do we go to the public school, the private school, open enroll? Does the foster family make that decision? Is it the DSS? Is it made together? Can you speak to that?
Absolutely. Thank you for that question, Madam Chair. So there are a number of different decision makers that play into making that decision when a child is in DSS custody. The biological parents still have rights to make educational decisions or provide input into the child's education. The child's caseworker through the Department of Social Services has the opportunity to provide input. The foster parents also have that opportunity as they're close to the child during that placement. The youth attorney or court-appointed special advocate can also play a role, and in some situations, the judge may even have some input into how those decisions are made. So the scholarship program wouldn't change how those decisions are made. It would just allow some additional options for these youth.
So Senator Boland will appreciate this. Harry Truman had a sign on his desk that said, "The buck stops here." You just mentioned about six different entities. Where does the buck stop here?
I think ultimately the buck probably stops with the circuit court judge if they need to come in and make a decision. I think in most cases you would see that the parties can come together and make the decision that's in the best interest of the child. If there would be a dispute on that, the judge in charge of that child's case would weigh in finally.
Okay. Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you.
Representative Otten.
Finishing the line of thought there. So if it's going to a judge, how much of a timeline are we looking at between these acts? I mean, is it we're going into months or to get something settled, or?
Thank you for that question, Madam Chair. No, I wouldn't anticipate, Representative, that it would take that kind of time. I mean, when we're talking about a scholarship for tutoring or teaching services or technology purchases, I don't anticipate those to be real controversial decisions. If it's a question between is a student going to attend public or private school, that would maybe be a decision that the judge would want to weigh into more thoroughly. But beyond that, I think some of these other expenses are things that could be fairly routine and would not be particularly controversial.
Representative Kasson.
Oh, I see. Okay. Thank you, Madam Chair. And again, I'm as Representative Van Hughes, and I'm not super up to date on foster care. But currently, if in this scenario, if a foster child, if the decision was made to go to a private school, who would pay for that?
Madam Chair. Thank you for that question, Representative. So currently there is a tax credit scholarship that is operated by Partners in Education. That's a scholarship that has existed for a number of years. Last year, foster children or children in foster care were added to the population that is eligible for that kind of scholarship. So in that situation, they could be eligible for a Partners in Education tax credit scholarship. They could also be eligible for this scholarship if we move forward. That could, you know, pay for a portion of that.
Follow up. So are the foster parents then aware of this, made aware of this scholarship? At some point, do they pay? I mean, is that a possibility? Again, I'm just trying to understand.
Yep, Madam Chair, Representative. The foster parents certainly could pay if they had the means to do so. We are trying to allow for other resources so that that's not necessarily required of them if the private school is the best option for the child.
One more. And so you mentioned if we don't, or this current program, but you mentioned a previous one. I can't remember what the name was. Are they given that information, and does that currently cover all of the students that are all of the foster students that choose to go to private school? Does that grant, I think is what you had indicated it was, does that cover all of those individuals and their cost to go to a private school currently?
Madam Chair, thank you for that question, Representative. The Partners in Education Tax Credit Scholarship is the program that currently exists. From the latest information I had, they were covering private school tuition for 9 foster children. We haven't heard that there's been any need beyond that number that haven't been able to have been funded through that program.
Thank you.
Representative Van Huysen.
Madam Chair, I would just add, I think the Partners in Education is capped at $3.5 million a year, and so there is an application process, and I don't believe they're able to cover everyone who applies. I don't know about foster kids particularly, but yeah.
Senator Boland.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. So living right close to the border with Iowa. Would somebody through this program be able to attend Inwood Christian right across the 8-9 miles from Canton?
Madam Chair, thank you for that question, Senator. No, the funding or the schools that are eligible must be located within the bounds of South Dakota.
They have to be within. They'd have to be within the boundaries of the state of South Dakota.
That's correct.
Thank you.
Representative Duba.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Ms. Ringley, you said that there were approximately 1,000 children right now that are eligible in the K through 12. So if we look at 1,000 children K through 12 times $4,000, that equates to $4 million a year, which is about $12 million over the three-year period. What are we doing with the other $3 million? Where is that going?
Madam Chair. Representative Duba, that's a great question. You know, between 1,000 and 1,200 students would be school age each year. So we're being conservative in our budget estimates. There'll also be some administrative expenses that go along with administering the program. And so there's some flexibility there to cover some of those expenses as well.
Follow up. So you're assuming that all 1,000 to 1,200 people are going to take advantage of this up to $4,000 a person? That's the assumption that you're making with this $15 million.
Madam Chair, Representative Duba, that's our conservative budget estimate. That's correct.
Where are you getting your data that is going, I mean, do you anticipate, I can't believe that tutoring, curriculum, and standardized tests are going to take $4,000 in my wildest dreams. So are we assuming that the majority of these children are going to go to a private school?
Madam Chair. Representative Duba, no, I don't believe that we're anticipating the large number of children in foster care will attend private school, but we did want to account for students eligible to use the full range of that scholarship.
Follow up. What is the process? I mean, who really is administering this? Why is DSS not in the equation, or are they in the equation? And who's going to be responsible? Because I got to believe there's got to be a process flow and an application flow and a tracking. So where is this going to reside, and has that been designed or developed?
Madam Chair, thank you for that question, Representative. So DSS will have involvement, obviously, as they are connected with the youth in foster care directly and have eyes on them regularly. The Department of Education is where the program would be administered. The Department of Education is really in the best position to promulgate administrative rules related to the program, to determine qualifying expenses, what qualifications a tutor would have, and those sorts of things related to the education of the youth.
The Department of Education really focuses on, and in the state of South Dakota, we focus on public education. Why the push towards private school? Why are we getting into the private school business with state funding dollars? It's a tough question, I know.
Madam Chair, really our intention with this program is to allow the youth to just be educated in the setting that's best for them. And so whether that be a public school or a private school, if that's what's best for that youth, we want to allow them access to that.
Okay, we're going to move on. Senator Boland.
Real quick. So if someone was in the foster care system and was, say they attended St. Lambert's Elementary School up in Sioux Falls, and then they accessed out of the system, then it would be the full authority of the parent who resumed control, day-to-day control of the child, to then make that decision whether or not they would stay there, and they could then, they might be removed from that school. Would that be at least a possibility?
Madam Chair. Senator Boland, thanks for your question. I'll go back one step. The way the program is designed, once a child is eligible for the scholarship, they retain that eligibility regardless of their placement outside the system. Our goal with children that come into DSS custody is permanency and primarily reunification, and we wouldn't want a student to lose access to resources just because they're returned home to their parent. So if the child was attending St. Lambert's, as you described, and they went back to their parents and their parents decided that, you know, that's the best place for them to be, they could still maintain their enrollment there and they could still receive scholarship funds for that. If the parent decided that wasn't in the best interest of their child any longer, they could be removed and placed in whatever school that the parent chooses.
One more brief follow-up. So if this happened when someone was in the second or third grade, and then would they be able to go all the way through O'Gorman, Gorman school system?
Madam Chair. That's a great question. Yeah. Under this bill, they would.
Thank you.
Other questions? Representative Mills.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So just kind of following that line, we've got 1,000 kids that are school age and in the foster care system. How many children are annually coming in and going out of that number?
Madam Chair, thank you for that question, Representative. When we looked at this program, we really looked at the four-year average of children that are in care, and that's around 1,700. I could get some additional information from the Department of Social Services to follow up on that incoming and outcoming trend.
Madam Chair, it just seemed that might be part of the budgeting as we're looking at that to be able to figure out tracking forward what we might need. So thank you.
Okay, just a few questions for me. Does anybody else have questions? Representative Kroll.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So if I, help me understand this, is if I have 4 foster children, I can get $16,000 in credit for education. And if I send them to a private school and they're in the first 4 grades, and this initiative is only going to last for 3 years, is that what you said?
That's correct.
So how am I going to get them to go for the rest of the, is it going to be continuous, or is this only going to be for 3 years? And then if I don't send my kids to the private schools, I can use that $4,000 for each one of those items, and who tracks that they are actually using it for those items? Thank you.
Sure. Madam Chair, Representative Kroll, I'll address the second piece of your question first, because that's the piece that's most fresh in my mind. So there is a requirement for the acting parent to sign an agreement that they're only going to use the funds for the specified purpose. They're also required to invoice either the department or the scholarship granting organization for the expenses incurred. It's not you get a check for $4,000 and you use that as you see fit. It is a reimbursement, and you do have to show that the expenses are allowable expenses under the program. And I'd ask you to maybe please repeat the first portion of your question.
Madam Chair? So if I'm sending a child, or how many child that I have, to a private school, and I get $4,000 to help offset their tuition to that, and so the program is going to last for 3 years, but I put them in at the first grade, what happens when they're in the fourth grade?
Sure. Madam Chair, Representative, you're correct. As I stated, this is a 3-year pilot, and so we'll be looking during that period to see what our utilization is and what our outcomes are for students that utilize the program. I believe the goal would be that if we see success, that we would want to come in 3 years from now and ask for a continuation of the program, but that's just something that we'll have to look at over the next 3 years.
Representative Colt.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. I'm trying to get on the same ship. Foster care, generally speaking, is for a limited time. I just Googled it. That can be dangerous. 18 to 24 months. Foster care kids may be with a foster care family. Then could be adopted, they could move out of that. But it's a very short period of time, as I understand it. And so that's what we're talking about here, is those kids, school-age kids, that are in foster care, that are school-age, right?
That's correct.
So the likelihood of that moving beyond 2 years probably is very unlikely, unless they're adopted or, am I on that right track or?
Madam Chair, Representative Koth, that's correct. Foster care is meant to be a short-term placement. We're always looking at reunification or permanency for children that come into foster care. With this program, a child who becomes eligible for the program would retain that program eligibility even after they receive that permanency, either back at home or with an adoptive or more permanent placement. However, some of the trauma and other you know, learning issues that occur due to that mobility are longer lasting than that time period. And so to be able to provide those children with this additional resource, we believe is important.
Any other questions? Private schools, do they have to be accredited schools or can they be non-accredited schools?
Madam Chair, they must be accredited under the legislation.
You don't have homeschoolers, so I'm assuming that is not part of the equation?
Madam Chair, that's correct. This scholarship is intended for students who are in a traditional school setting. The funds would not be available to pay for alternative instruction.
Question, do you know under the foundation that exists, the tax exempt for the insurance companies for that was started, what is the average scholarship for those children that's going out?
Madam Chair, I don't have that information today, but I can certainly follow up with that.
Okay. And I believe that information, those scholarships are to schools, to private schools, and does not include any of these other criteria. Is that, do you know that?
Madam Chair, that's correct.
And just to clarify, you said there were seven students that there certainly have, or more?
Madam Chair, the most recent number I had was nine students.
Okay, and then one last question. I keep going that way. So the processing, knowing how they process theirs, they make the decisions who gets the scholarships, that group. Am I hearing you say from the beginning, multiple people are going to be stakeholders to decide where that child is going to go, but yet the money is being housed in a different fund under a different authority?
Sure, Madam Chair. I'll try to do my best to explain the process a little bit. So the decision making that happens today related to where a child is schooled once they come into Department of Social Services custody isn't changing, and that's something that's made by kind of a variety of stakeholders. Once it would be determined that a child would best be educated in particularly a private school setting, then the scholarship granting organization or the department would reimburse for that tuition. So they're not making the decision on where the child would go. They would be simply reimbursing for the tuition expense.
So why are they housing the money?
Madam Chair, the Department of Education would be housing the money just due to the fact that that's where the appropriation would go. A scholarship granting organization would not have any money being housed with them unless the student was eligible. So it would go through the scholarship granting organization to the school or to the parent.
So to understand, they're just the routing. So if I have a child, I get the $4,000 to go to St. Benedict's School, you would pay the existing foundation, and then they would send that money over to St. Benedict's for tuition?
Madam Chair, that's my understanding, but I can certainly get some clarification on that process.
Okay, thank you. Just a reminder, we are here having a hearing on this. This is a bill, correct?
So
this is a bite at the first apple to get information, but we will have a hearing on that. So now you have some basis premonition of what you're looking at and what additional you would like to glean. Anything else? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, members of the committee, our next topic is one-time appropriations. I'm going to move through these fairly quickly because of the time factor. So one of those was the South Dakota Virtual School, a $200,000 allocation. That particular school is still going quite well. What we did with the dollars was to boost the virtual school website and had a full redesign of that. The idea of the South Dakota Virtual School, of course, is to provide flexibility and some choice and quality for all students. That updated website and system launched in October of 2022, so that is underway. A next initiative was the education or certification system at about $1.5 million, and that is preparing to launch in late February, so we're coming up on that very quickly. That's been a...
Jen, Representative Duba.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So we allocated funding for this last year, and now we're coming back and asking for an additional $1.5 million. Is that what I'm understanding? Or so FY21, what are you asking? Am I lost? I'm lost.
Madam Chair? Okay, just to clarify, no, we're reporting on dollars that were expended in the past and just telling you how they were expended.
Okay, sorry about that. Thank you.
Correct. So the education certification system, earlier you mentioned how, you know, we need to have an automated system, and we now have that system. Again, we're going to prepare to launch in February. Final one was the K-12 Civics and History Initiative for $900,000, and that provided grants to schools, instructional materials and resources, professional development, and guide for selecting materials. Interestingly, about a tenth of that dollars was actually provided to grants to schools, and the rest of the dollars were or are being spent under those other initiatives as well. I'm going to move on then to special appropriations. And to do that, the Cultural Heritage Center is a very significant one, and I'm going to invite Ben Jones back to the chair.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. Ben Jones, the state historian. Just wanted to take the opportunity today to update you on the appropriation that we've spoken of a little bit a few moments ago. Last year, this committee and the legislature approved House Bill 1047 that provided for the renovation of the Cultural Heritage Center. It was first built in 1989, and after 33 years of wear and tear and use, it needs some updates. In particular, on this chart in front of you on the slide, you can see where the bill appropriated the funds. There's kind of three colors of money. Two colors of money are in the bill. One was the general appropriation to the Department of Education for the renovation of the facility. The other was the authority to expend up to $3.3 million in other funds for enhancing the museum exhibits. And then the further money is approximately $7.7 million from M&R that the Bureau of Administration is programming in to do a lot of the M&R updates over the past decade or so that's needed for HVAC systems, for electrical work, and for updating carpets and so forth in the facility. You see before you the latest rendition of the ISG architectural plans. From the exterior side, the biggest change is the addition of that lodge on the front. So if you've been to the facility before, and if you've participated in the receptions and other activities there, you've probably had experiences in what's now the Vote Education Room. This room kind of maxes out at about 40 people. We are adding on this additional space for activities, museum activities, for book talks, and for other public events that would be in here. We expect this to kind of almost double our space in that area. And the lodge design is enhancing the original Arikara design of the building, the tribes that were in this area as a part of our state's history. So, and that design is near what the engineers called 50% complete with the design. We sat in the latest meeting about a 7-hour walkthrough of the design on Monday to update that. We expect that bids will go out for the work next month. We are in negotiations with a private entity to help us manage the movement of the artifacts and the archival documents. Some will be leaving the building, some will be stored in place while the construction is occurring. And we're being very selective about what leaves the building due to the dust and so forth we expect from the construction activities and what can stay inside the building. We expect to hire a consultant for the museum enhancements that will begin, and that will be privately funded. We've walked through with the designer that helped us in the 1990s is now a firm called Split Rock, and Split Rock has helped us with the schematic design number one. We expect that design work will then evolve into a schematic design number two, and then that would ultimately be a build design for a new museum that would occur sometime in the 2024, 2025, 2026 timeframe. But the building will be reopened in 2025 when the renovation is complete. We expect the construction to be done sometime in mid or early 2025, creating more space for the archival records and for the artifacts. The staff, I noticed Senator Kolbach has left the room, but his previous question about what are those 40 people going to be doing? We're going to be very busy doing one of two things, continuing our public outreach with what we're calling Taking History on the Road. So the museum in particular, while it won't be open to the public, the staff will be doing primarily two things, helping design the future museum and then also taking certain exhibits on the road to be displayed around the state. And we're inviting people who want to help us exhibit our history in their facility, whether they're a county museum or another space that can do that and is open to the public and would have the climate control that we would expect of some place like that and also the security for that, so that we can exhibit the artifacts outside of the museum while we're doing that. We also expect to have a small exhibit at the Northridge Mall, which is where the museum staff will be working from, as well as the archival staff will be up at the Northridge Mall. The rest of us will be at the Becker Hansen building for that duration of the renovation. The press will continue to publish books. They'll continue to do that work, and the shipping and receiving of those items and those books, and historic preservation will continue that. And, of course, the ARC in Rapid City will continue on. They just went through a move a couple years ago, and they are very happy where they are. So they're very glad now that the shoe is on the other foot and we get to go through the renovation changes. We expect to break ground in May for when the construction will begin. And you'll probably see some work happening on the front of the building and then also around to the back where on the north side of the building that faces the state health lab, there's a loading dock, and we're going to add an annex onto the back there to increase more space for the archival and art and museum storage collections. Let's see. And I think I covered my bullets. If there's any questions on.
Two points I'd like to make. First, I want to compliment Dr. Jones on his work as state historian. He has a podcast called the 605 History Podcast I would highly recommend. I'm not used to listening to you when you're not speaking on double time, so I'm having to adjust to that.
I'm not.
Secondly, though, on this topic, this is a suggestion for you, Madam Chair. I somehow found myself as the chairman of the fundraising committee for the $3 million in private funds they need to refresh the museum. Also on that committee with me is our clerk of the House, former First Lady Pat Miller. So next time someone's phone go off, perhaps you consider the State Historical Society Foundation.
Yes, we'll do.
Thank you.
I'll take
yes. Representative Mills.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Dr. Jones, good to have you here today. As I look at the plan and I'm remembering what I looked at a year ago, it looks to me like it's maybe scaled back some. There was more construction on the front of the structure is what my mind is telling me. Have you had to scale it back in order to stay within budget? Are you anticipating you will be seeking additional funds? What can you tell me about that?
Madam Chair. We are not anticipating seeking additional funds this year. We did scale it back as we worked through with ISGN the design. It was, you know, for lack of a better word, it was kind of Christmas as we sat there in June and July of last year and late last year, just before we did the renderings that you saw with the glass addition on the front. That's a noticeable difference from the previous time. So we have cut that off or taken that out of the plan. The cost of storage was more than we expected, and so we had to find some money, and that's part of the funds we found.
Madam Chair, follow up. So is this design being done in such a way that the previous design that we saw can be added later, or is this a total rethink, we're going to do something different?
Madam Chair, I wouldn't call it a total rethink. We worked with the engineers to say what can we scale back that would be the easiest changes to make, and we found that extending I think it was 16 feet out in front there that would extend the staff's office spaces was something that was a really a nice to have. We would rather properly care for the items both in the short-term storage needs as well as the long-term annex that we'll need to be adding on to the back of the back corner of the building. So the money, some of the money that we saved from not adding that front extension is going into the annex in the back and then also this proper storage for temporary purposes over the next 18 months to 2 years.
All right. Thank you.
Madam Chair, the remainder of our program talks about K-12.
Mr. Secretary, I'm going to stop you. There is a consensus among my team here that there is a concern that we will run too fast through this.
Okay.
So is there potential that you could return? We'll continue on. I'm not going to cut you off, but so that everybody gets their questions. Would you consider coming back tomorrow morning from 8 to 9 and finalizing if what you didn't get done and so we have adequate time for questions?
Absolutely.
Okay. So we don't want to put you on a rushing, want to make sure everybody gets the information. So go ahead. I will still take public testimony about 20 to 12. And then if you'll come back and finish up and then people can sort of ponder and think of what they might have asked if we've had the additional time.
Thank
you for your flexibility. I appreciate that.
Of course. K-12 education, before we talk about the state aid and the COVID funding, I just want to talk a little bit about what we oversee in school year 21-22, so last year, we had 10,168 teachers in public schools, 735 in non-public accredited schools. Again, we don't include the non-accredited here. 423 in tribal BIE schools for a total of 11,326. The same numbers apply approximately for administrators, except at a lower number, of course, and then educational specialists as well. In terms of the K-12 fall census enrollment, you'll see the number of students there between 2014 and 2022. And what you're going to see there is an increase overall in the public school enrollments. There was some kind of an interruption in many school districts during the COVID, but overall, we've moved from about 130,000 to about 138,000 between those 8 years. Non-public enrollment has actually gone down since then. But again, it's holding pretty steady between 16,100 and 15,100. So,
Representative Duba.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Is there any way that we know or can account for students that are either not in public school or in non-public school? In other words, I'm talking about homeschool. Where do we track that number?
Madam Chair. We do indeed track that number. I'm trying to see if I have those. Yeah, I do have those here, I believe. Homeschool enrollment in the last 5 years has gone from, in the 2018-19 school year, 5,046 to this current year, an estimated 9,120. And the reason I say estimated is there isn't a specific count date for homeschool as there is with public and private school enrollment, so a little bit different. So we have definitely seen an increase from about 5,000 to 9,000 over that time period.
And Representative Derby.
Thank you, Madam Chair. On the school staff slide, Secretary Graves, so administrators 579, teachers 10,168. That's are those metrics you look at and compare across the country? That's one administrator for every 17 and a half teachers. Is that a thing that's looked at? Are we comparable? And what defines an administrator also?
Madam Chair.
Go ahead.
An administrator is considered a certified administrator, including certain categories like superintendent, principal, typically an activities director, et cetera. There are administrators who are not generally counted in this number. For example, non-accredited or rather non-certified administrators, say director of buildings and grounds, those kinds of things. So some of both. In terms of the numbers, we are pretty much commensurate with the nation. We look at those numbers. Unfortunately, I do not have those numbers in front of me at this point, but I could be happy to provide those.
Representative Kroll.
Thank you for that information. Can you refresh my memory? How many school districts do we have now?
We have 149, I believe. Yes, 149, Madam Chair.
Representative, do you have a follow-up?
No.
Oh, that's okay. Representative Van Huys. Nope. Okay.
Thank you. That brings us to the state aid, which, of course, is the lion's share of our budget. And I'll turn that over to Cody Stoser.
Madam Chair, Cody Stoser, Department of Education. In front of you, you'll see the breakdown of the state aid and how we come to the number of $24 million. I did hand out, Carter assisted me with handing out a school funding state aid snapshot. Gives a little history of where we were at with that since FY13. There's some history there. And then another document that shows how the calculation is done with school state aid funding with this packet where it says funding K-12 education in South Dakota. So you can kind of follow along. We call it the game board that we have. The general state aid education's in the inside of it, and then the special education is on the outside back side of that. So sorry, since we're short of time, we can I'll try not to go too fast for you, so stop me if I'm going too fast.
We already have a question. Representative Derby.
All right.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just wanted to compliment you on this. Very helpful, very simple. Be very nice at a Cracker Barrel this weekend. Thank you.
Very simple. I don't get that very often when we're talking about state aid. And Representative Van Huysen can probably attest to that, too.
This was 6 or 8 years ago, but we had a national consultant come in one time who told us that we had one of the simplest funding formulas in the country. So wrap your mind around that.
Yeah. Madam Chair, well, in I think it was Senate Ed or Ed House Ed the other day, they said it's the most complex system around. So anyway, we'll dive into it a little bit. On the screen, you'll have what we have is the target teacher compensation that we calculate, and that's where when the governor comes in with the 5% increase to state aid education, that gets applied to that number to come up with that $75,000. If you're relating that back to the state aid snapshot, there's the target teacher salary column on there in the middle of it to show you where we've come from since FY17 of $48,500 to where we're at with the total compensation. So the snapshot shows the teacher salary. This shows the target teacher compensation. So that $58,000 for the proposed for FY24 is part of the $75,000 of the total teacher compensation. The next step on the process is how do we get to the target teacher, a number of target teachers, and we have a ratio that comes up with how we get to the target teacher, and that is 14-1 to come up with the target teacher, targeted number of teachers in the state aid formula. Did you have a question? Next, we take in the calculation of English language learners. English language learners gets a bump of 0.25 for every student that is English language learner that scores a 4 or below on their access test. That is then added on to the total target teacher number, which is roughly this year 9,688 teachers that we are targeting. The total teacher compensation is $731 million, roughly. Next, we move into the overhead rate.
We have a question.
Oh, sorry.
Representative Kroll.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I have a question on could you explain to me and the rest of the board the target teacher compensation rate? It's at 29%, right? Or what are we talking about here?
The target, Madam Chair, the target teacher compensation, that is where if back when the Blue Ribbon Task Force set, and you can look at your snapshot, they set up a target teacher salary, and part of that is in this the rest of it, the 29% is the benefit rate of the teachers that we're taking into account to come up with a total target teacher compensation. So we take that 29% into account with that.
Follow up. So we've got the 29% is the target teacher's salary. And then for the target teacher compensation, the overhead rate is what?
Madam Chair, okay. The two different things between 29% for benefit rate and then the overhead rate. So what we're computing for target teacher compensation is for the general salaries of your school, what you're going to need for that at your school. The overhead rate is for everything else to fund your school, other than teacher salaries. So that's where that 38.78 is. Part of the formula for state aid is to help schools with other needs of their school to help fund those things.
Follow up? Okay. I think we're talking about the same thing. We've got the target teacher salary, you know, and you started that from the teacher compensation. And then the, so then we went to the compensation, which is, which percentage was that again now?
So, Madam Chair, so we started at, so if you look at your snapshot, mm-hmm. there's the line that has a target teacher salary. So back when, in FY17, that was our target teacher salary that we used to compute state aid or help compute state aid. Well, we take in 29% of the benefit rate in there to come up with the total teacher compensation. So this year, if you look at the bottom of proposed FY24, the target teacher salary is $58,000. You take into account the 29% of that for the benefit rate, comes up with the total compensation, teacher compensation of $75,000, roughly $75,000.
So the teacher compensation is a salary plus the benefits?
Yes.
Correct?
Yes.
Okay, so then you go with the overhead cost. Have you got to that yet?
We did kind of talk about that just a little bit ago. So the overhead rate, which is calculated at 38.78%, is the other funds that help with the rest of the school funding. So that helps with other things other than the general teachers. So maybe you have counselors or whatnot that you're paying for. The counselors are not part of the target teacher compensation. That falls under the overhead rate of how you fund those positions or specialists. And Dr. Graves could talk about specialists if you want, but that covers that cost of those other things of running a school.
So once we get to that total number, you know, per student allocation, and basically it's the teachers now. It isn't per student anymore. That is the paralegals and everything else. How about the rest of the facility? Where does that number come in?
The rest of the facility would fall under the overhead rate. So we're funding at 38.78% for the rest of the operations of the school. So about 60% is going towards teachers, and almost 40% is going to help fund the rest of the school.
Mm-hmm. Follow up? Excuse me, and thank you for walking me through this. So the 29% is for the benefits. The 38.8% is for the rest of the school, paras, everything else that goes into that. Where did those two percentages come from?
Madam Chair. Morgan Griebel with the Bureau of Finance and Management. Representative, that is a wonderful question. 29% was when the Blue Ribbon Task Force was created, they went back and looked at surrounding states, averages, historical information within they kind of did a full review of everything. 29% was the average benefit rate. So that was what was created at that time. That hasn't been evaluated or looked at, but we've moved that forward at this point. Back when, for the overhead rate, that actually started at 31%. That was a two-year average of the overhead cost additionally to run a school. That started at 31%. That has moved up to 38.78 based on the other revenue sources as those have been brought into the funding formula. Cody will touch on that a little bit later in the yellow box, but those are those six other revenue sources that had been equalized into the formula based on kind of previous discussions based on that. So hopefully that gives you a little bit of background.
Thank you.
Follow up?
Yeah.
So with the target salaries and the benefits, and we'll just work on that one for a little bit, that 29%. All the school districts have to report to the Department of Education basically everything that they do, teacher pay, benefits, and everything like that. Does that 29% plus the targeted teacher compensation, is that covering that amount?
Madam Chair, every school district is different on how they operate benefits and their benefits packages. So when the schools report, they're reporting salaries, but a teacher might not take the benefits. So what we're doing is projecting out here of what we think what will happen if a teacher would take all benefits. So in the school district, they make a decision. Teachers say, hey, my husband's package for health benefits is better than what I'm receiving through the school. That might be the case of they're not getting that from us.
Follow up. And the 29% for the benefits and the teacher compensation, the 29% was set in 2016?
Madam Chair, yes, the Blue Ribbon Task Force, like Ms. Griebley said, is they set that rate at 29%, looking at the surrounding areas and whatnot.
Okay. Well, thank you for that. Is there any way that that 29%, is there any thought about revisiting that?
Madam Chair, we haven't had those discussions yet, but I think it could be revisited at any time. Okay.
Madam Chair, thank you. Okay.
Madam Chair, something to note on that. When you look at the formula in itself, when we put an inflationary factor on the salary, target teacher compensation itself, when you add the 29% onto the inflated number, that 29% receives that inflation in a way as that amount goes through. So just something to note, even though we're not necessarily adding in an increase to that percentage, that does receive, as we add an inflationary amount to the beginning part of the formula, that benefit rate does receive a bump through that formula.
Thank you. Madam Chair. So now if we can go to the 38.8% for the overhead cost. Again, my question is that enough to do all the rest of a school district's cost?
Madam Chair, it kind of depends on what you're saying, all the rest. Are you saying like capital improvements or just general functions of their school?
Well, the improvements and stuff like that come from the capital outlay.
Yes.
You know, and there's different fundings, special revenues and things like that come, but what are we attributing that 38.8% to? I mean, what, for a school district to say, this is what you should be spending for this 38.8%?
So I don't have specific, if you're talking about specific schools, if they're not funded properly, I don't have that in front of me. I'm trying to wrap my head around your question on that.
Mm-hmm.
But when we put in the other revenues, there are other revenues from the individual districts that are making up part of this 38.78% to cover the state aid portion of this. So they're reporting those other revenues, which includes like bank tax, bank franchise tax, wind farms, some other things, and LUA taxes that they receive. That drives the 38.78%. So as those got put into the system, equalized, that's why that 38% has risen, or from 31% up to 38%, we started equalizing more of those revenues into the system to help cover the cost of those schools with those dollar amounts.
Can I just stop for, and I'm not stopping you, Representative Van Huysen was involved with that, so he has some commentary.
Yeah, I just wanted to add, when that other revenue percentage was originally set, I was on the Blue Ribbon Task Force, most of you probably know that. We looked at what was being spent on salary and benefits, and then we looked at what was being spent on everything else, and we looked at what the new money going in would add to salary and benefits, and the other percentage was based on what was being spent on everything other than salary benefits at that time. So the idea was, it wasn't an increase or a decrease. It was just to reflect reality at that time. And then, as Mr. Stoser said, as those other revenues have come into the formula, they've been added to that side, because there wasn't an expectation, since the schools were already receiving that other revenue just outside the formula, there didn't want to be an expectation that they had to put it into salaries when it presumably was being used for other things before. So it was an attempt to reflect the reality at that time.
So thank you for that information. So far we've determined that, you know, what the teacher's salary should be and their benefits, correct? Yep. So in this formula, that's going through there. And a school doesn't have to have 14 per, you know, and it's accelerated or a rate of 12.1 to either 15.1 for student to teachers. I think that's what it is with the small schools to the large schools. And then we've figured out what the target teacher's salaries are. We figured out what the benefits added to that. And we figured out what the overhead cost is so far. Is that correct?
Yep.
That's where we're at now.
That's correct.
Thank you for letting me go through that with you.
No problem. All right. So,
okay, I'm just going to ask, because it's 22. I just need to ask, are we at a place that be comfort zone that we can resume tomorrow, or I can forego the public testimony and we can hear the rest on this slide and go through that and then pick up in the morning? I'm asking the committee. What? Okay. I think we're going to probably conclude for, unless you had something particular.
Not really.
Okay. All right. You know where we're at. You know what kind. We all need a 101 on this. So,
Madam Chair,
we'll resume tomorrow. Yes.
Are you also saying that if there is public testimony, that we're going to stop that right now, too?
No, I'll take the public testimony, all right? But if it doesn't get completed, we'll have to work it in the morning, okay?
Yeah.
I don't know if you were here when we said we're going to start at 8 tomorrow. Okay, so everybody knows, 8 o'clock start tomorrow, we'll pick up with the Department of Ed.
Madam Chair, I did want to clarify, I don't plan to bring the whole group back tomorrow. We've got a lot of schedules, but we'll bring back the people where necessary.
Absolutely. Since we already had those questions, absolutely. I want to be respectful of their work and that, but I thank you in advance again for your flexibility with us. Okay, public testimony. Y'all know my public testimony rules, right? Succinct. And no repetition, me too, or new information.
Good morning, Madam Chairman and members of the committee. Wade Pogany from Associated School Boards. Let me start by apologizing for my interruption of the phone. I'm embarrassed, and so I'll be indebted to the chairman for the rest of my life. But that was my retirement gift, so I'll keep working. But and I know you've been struggling with my retirement gift, Madam Chair. So if I have some ideas, and they're in-state aid, if you want to know about those. But you know, given the time sequence we have here and getting this done, I'll be brief. So let me do this. I know there will be other opportunities to talk about state aid. Okay, so what I'm handing you is a document that we created for you, and it just gives you some graphs and some data about where school boards are, and some of the pressure points that we're facing, and what we're up against. So let's do this. If you would, and I know you're very, very busy, but when you have time, or if you have time, take a look at this, and when we meet again, maybe on Senate Bill 24 or another place, then I can talk about this with you. But there are several pressure points that school boards are up against, and I represent all 850 school board members. We're very interested in state aid, obviously, but things like teacher shortage, competitiveness, we know we're getting behind compared to other states. We know that we have more kids in the system right now. Inflation is killing us. And so there are other, you know, pressure points, I call them, that we're up against. So rather than walk you through all those, I'll just leave it at that, Madam Chair, and say I'll be back and we can visit another time.
Thank you. And that's good that we can have a preview and we can go through it and then come back. Anybody else? Oh, that was quick. Okay. Well, again, thank you, and we will continue tomorrow morning. If we have time afterward for continuing with public testimony, we will do that. Okay? All right. So I think that concludes our business for today. And we have work groups that will be meeting this afternoon, keeping that in mind. And so with that, I would entertain a motion.
So moved. Second.
Second.
Moved by Senator Boland, second by Representative Carr. All those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carried. We are adjourned. Remember.
Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of SDPB. Links to live events and their archives are available at sd.net. Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of SDPB. Follow us on Twitter at SDNet for announcements about what's coming up. Thank you.